See, in atomic structure, the most important part is the Bohr's model and the Planck's theory, and then finally the quantum mechanical model. Okay. So, please. Okay. So first, simple basics of atoms. I'm not going to teach again Dalton's theory. Many of you know Dalton's theory, that it is atoms are indivisible, etc. And then first scientist who discovered that atoms are divisible was actually Faraday, who started with the cathode ray experiments. And then J.J. Thomson developed on the cathode ray experiments and found out the electrons E by M ratio, right? So the cathode ray experiment has some understandings that electrons are having mass, kinetic energy, and negative charge. Okay. And the charge of an electron is 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 coulombs. And the mass of electron is 9.1 into 10 power minus 31 kgs. Okay. Later on, proton was also discovered. I'm just putting all the values here. The charge of proton is plus 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 coulombs. Mass of proton is approximately 1.67 into 10 power minus 24 grams. Here, the magnitude of charge of proton and electron are same, and they are just negative and positive. They are different in nature, but the magnitudes are same. That point has to be noted. Then we have neutron, whose charge is zero and whose mass is approximately equal to mass of proton. One more value which you should know is mass of proton to mass of electron is approximately 1836, whereas mass of neutron to mass of electron is approximately 1839. So this proves that the mass of neutron is slightly greater than mass of proton. Okay, but for calculations we use it as almost same. It is basically varying in the 25th decimal. So it is greater, but then we neglect that. Okay. Now coming to the, in the starting of this class, I have told about mass number and atomic number. Okay. Based on the different kinds of species have been categorized, like you have something called as isotopes. Isotopes are species having same atomic number but different mass number, right? So because same atomic number is there, every atom is defined by number of protons present inside the nucleus. Okay, not the electrons, not the neutrons. Atom is defined by number of protons. So because same Z is there and Z is number of protons, they belong to same element. So, examples we can give: hydrogen has three isotopes, protium, deuterium, and tritium. Similarly, chlorine has two isotopes, Cl35 and Cl37. Similarly, uranium has very important two isotopes, uranium-238 and uranium-235, and so on. Now, going to the next concept. That is average atomic mass in a mixture of isotopes. For example, I have two isotopes A and B, whose atomic masses are A and B, and let's say their percentage is X percentage and Y percentage. We can calculate the average atomic mass of this mixture as X into A plus Y into B by X plus Y. Okay. Because of this, many of the atoms have average, like decimal number. For example, chlorine is 35.5, right? That is because approximately 75% is chlorine 35 atom and approximately 25% is the chlorine 37. Okay. And generally x plus y will be equal to 100 because the total percentage will be 100. The next species you should know is about isobars. Isobars bars have different mass atomic number and the same mass number. Example what we can give for that is
argon
and calcium. Argon is 1840, calcium is 2040. Then we will talk about isotones. Isotones have same number of neutrons, which can be calculated by A minus Z value. We can write, there are many species with this, like I can write sodium 1123 and magnesium 1224. I can write phosphorus 1631, sulfur 1632. How will I am telling this? 23 minus 11 is 12, 24 minus 12 is 12, 31 minus 16, sorry, 15 is 16, 32 minus 16 is also 16. So these are all isotones. Another kind of species is isoelectronic species. Okay, more understanding, this will come again in periodic table. So Manjana sir teaches periodic table, we can come there. Surya has raised his hand. Any doubt, Surya?
Yes sir, how many types of isotones and all are there, sir?
There are many, you can't make the full list. So in a given question, they will ask which of the following is isotones. Just calculate A minus Z values. If it is coming same, they are isotones. Otherwise not. Don't go for remembering these things. Okay. Always try to see in the question and answer. Okay. This is not something which you have to remember. You can always see the question and answer it then and there. If same A is there, they are isobars. If same Z is there, they are isotopes. If same A minus Z is there, they are isotones. Isoelectronic means they have same number of electrons. Surya, mute your audio. Thank you. So isoelectronic means they have same number of electrons. Okay. One example of isoelectronic species I can give is F minus Ne, Na plus, Mg2 plus. Fluorine has 9 electrons and it acquired 1 electron, so it is 10. Ne, neon has 10 electrons. Sodium has 11 electrons, where 1 electron is lost, it is 10. Magnesium is 12 minus 2, it's also 10. Okay, so just try to understand these concepts. Okay. Somebody yes
sir, where is this will this be useful for us, for isotones and isoelectronic?
There have been many times they have asked questions. They will give four options which is having four species. Which of the following is isoelectronic? Which of the following is not isoelectronic?
I mean not from exam point of view, I mean in actual practical use, where will this be useful for us?
You will understand that. Isoelectronic species, you will understand in periodic table. Okay, just hold your thought there. In periodic table, for isoelectronic species, radius changes in a particular way, that you will understand there. So there you need to. Okay, you mute yourself. Lot of noise is there. Mayur?
Sir, it's not me. Someone else.
Yeah, going to the next concept. See, much of this background history of how the atom came into picture is not so relevant for any competitive exams. Okay, we have studied them in the 10th class. I'll just quickly recap them. First, I told Thomson J.J. Thomson discovered electron by using cathode ray tube experiment. Correct? What he did was, he took a sealed glass tube with two electrodes in it, and when he connected high voltage through the vacuum, a rays passed from the cathode to anode, correct, based on which he discovered electrons. Then after that, he proposed the first ever model of atom, where he said atom is like a sphere in which much of the thing is the whole thing is engraved by positive charge, and in between there is negative charge. Okay, this you have studied in your, I think CBSE students have studied in 9th class, and even ICSE students would have studied in the 9th class. This model was outrightly rejected because negative charge cannot just stay with positive charge like that. Then the first groundbreaking experiment was done by Rutherford. This is a very important experiment. Rutherford did an experiment called alpha ray scattering experiment, right? So he took a alpha ray. What is an alpha ray? Alpha ray is nothing but helium atom with no electrons and are having two positive charge. When he hit a very thin gold foil, and when he surrounded the whole thing with a screen, he observed that much of the rays went through, which proves that atom is empty, and very few of them deflected back, correct, which proves that first is atom is mostly empty and positive charge is present concentrated at nucleus. He gave the term nucleus. Okay, so he, just to give an understanding, if I take a very big cricket stadium, in that if I put a tennis ball, right, that is the ratio of our atom versus the nucleus. Okay, the approximate size of an atom, approximate size of an atom is around 10 power minus 8 centimeters, whereas approximate size of nucleus is 10 power minus 13 centimeters. So there's a difference of 10 power 5 between the atom and the nucleus. And nucleus holds what? Protons and neutrons. Okay, so this is the alpha ray scattering experiment, which is a very important experiment in the history. Then Rutherford proposed the first next model of atom, where Rutherford proposed that the positive charge is concentrated in the nucleus and all the negative charged electrons are revolving around the nucleus in circular paths, like planet revolves around the sun. The main drawback of this model is he was not able to establish how the electrons are keep on rotating without losing the energy. That is the main defect of the Rutherford's model, because any charged particle, when it moves around another charged particle, it loses energy, and this electrons will eventually take a spiral path and fall on the nucleus. To explain Rutherford's model, we will go to the Bohr's model, okay, where this model is properly explained. But before going there, you need to understand few important concepts regarding the nature of light. So the dual nature of light has to be properly understood. So if I just consider light as a wave, which we normally do, a wave consists of a crust and a trough. This is a crust, this is a trough. This height of the wave is called as amplitude, and the length of one wave is called as wavelength, denoted by lambda, and number of waves passing through a particular point is called nu. Now nu units are hertz, lambda units will be meters or picometers or nanometers, etc. Amplitude is also in terms of intensity, etc. In terms of sorry, give me 1 minute, I'm just muting myself. Okay, so these are the different characteristics of a wave. One more important term we describe is wave number. Wave number is denoted by nu bar, which is nothing but 1 by lambda, number of waves present in 1 meter. These are the different quantities which we can tell regarding a particular wave. Now you need to know that the multiplication of
frequency. Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Can you please explain again nu and nu bar?
Okay. Nu is number of waves passing through a particular point in 1 second. Okay. Nu units, actual SI units will be second inverse. But to honor Hertz, a scientist, they gave the term Hertz to it. Whereas nu bar is called wave number. It is number of waves present in 1 meter. That is 1 by lambda. This is a difference. Okay. Clear now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Nu into lambda is equal to c. C is the velocity of light, that is 3 × 10⁸ meter per second. This value has to be remembered, and this equation is very important. Okay. Shall I go to the next part? Anyone please respond? Okay. Now the next part is spectrum. Now generally there are many kinds of light which we are there present in the universe. Now we arrange them in the increasing order of lambda or decreasing order of frequency, that is called as spectrum. In a light spectrum, there are many different lights that are there. In the middle, what we know, VIBGR is there. Violet, indigo, blue, green, YOR, where red has the highest wavelength. How can I remember? I think you would have heard this statement many times in your school. Why we use red for a signal? Because it has highest wavelength. If you remember that, you can always write this. Now, if you ever see a TV remote, if you can try it at home also. Take a simple your mobile camera, point the remote through it. You will see red color pointer at the starting of the remote because it is infrared remote. Okay. It shows has a little bit of red color and you cannot perceive it with your eye because your camera can see infrared because of which you can see. Then after that you have microwave and then you have radio waves, all our FM, AM, and satellite transmissions all fall under radio waves. Toward the left side of visible rays, you have UV rays, ultraviolet rays. Then you have gamma rays, which are coming from radioactivity. Then you have, X-rays. Then you have gamma rays. Am I correct? No. Yes, X-rays, gamma rays. And then finally, there is cosmic rays. Okay. So this is the spectrum which you should remember. Now you should know that visible range is generally between 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers. Okay. And generally, rather than using nanometer, we use another term for wavelength called angstroms. Now nano means 10⁻⁹. Now one angstrom is equal to 10⁻¹⁰ meters or 10⁻⁸ centimeters. Okay. This is a unit which you should know. Angstrom. angstrom will be rigorously used in all the calculations in atomic structure problems. Okay, so this is regarding structure. Yes.
What is the rays after infrared rays?
Microwaves.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir.
Our microwave is there, right? Oven. There is microwaves there. Okay, so this is all about understanding of the wave nature of the light. The next part
can come from this from board point of view.
Can you?
What kind of questions will come from board point of view?
Definitions. What is frequency? One mark questions from this part.
Okay.
One mark questions. They will not ask more than that from this part. The next part, which is there, right? The particle nature, that is very important. And you know who asked the question just now?
The Sriraksha.
Okay. So now next point is the particle nature. Okay. So before going there, we will understand one thing called black body is defined, which can absorb every wavelength. Okay. So this definition of black body made people think, how can a wave be absorbed? Okay. So that's when Max Planck proposed Planck's quantum theory, which is the basis of all this, you know, atomic structure. He said that light travels in packets of energy called quanta. How can I understand? You just imagine yourself, like for example, if you are standing below a water shower, right? You're small droplets of water falling on you, correct? It's not a continuous flow of water. Even if it is continuous flow of water, it is small water molecules that are flowing down, right? That you can visualize. Similarly, think now you are standing, now just look up, you will find some light, right? That light is like water shower. Instead of water molecules falling, quantas of light are falling on you. Okay, so Planck proposed that light is discretely continuous flow of energy. Okay, that discrete packets of energy is termed as quanta. Okay, and for light specifically, it is termed as photon. Okay, this quanta are termed as photons. Okay, and he defined what is the energy of each packet. Now, the good part of this theory is he based the energy based on the frequency. So this Planck's quantum theory, while explaining the particle nature, did not disregard the wave nature of the light. So E is equal to h nu. Okay, now nu is coming from the wave, correct? So that means he is relating the particle nature of the light with the wavelength of the light. Okay, now this is the energy of one packet. Now if I have n packets, energy En will be n into h nu. Okay, this is one of the important equations based on which questions can come from board also, from competitive point also, they can give direct questions. Now, if you remember previously, I had taught you just in the starting of the spectrum part that nu into lambda is equal to C, which means nu is equal to C by lambda. If I just substitute that here, I will get E is equal to HC by lambda. Okay. So depending on the question given, if they give frequency, you will use this. If they give wavelength, you can use this formula. I hope I gave
it. So can you please explain it again?
Which one?
From quanta packets.
Okay. Can I know who asked the question? Riya.
Riya. Yeah.
I'm just telling it again.
Yes, sir.
Light, okay, is not a continuous flow of energy. It is discrete. Discrete means what? Think like this. Let's say I'm trying to slap you, right? It's like I'm slapping you continuously. It is continuous, but it is discretely continuous, right? You're getting slap, one slap after another slap, right? But it is continuous because you're getting one after one slap. But it is not continuous in the sense that you're getting one slap, then some rest time, then another slap. It is a little cruel understanding, but then easy to understand. I think you would have got some or other slap from your parents sometime of your life. So easy to relate this thing. So similarly, light, okay, is not a continuous flow of energy. It's like, you know, you have seen in movies or somewhere, right? They play this tennis ball in practice. That ball fellow, that the machine will be kept, and it is throwing one ball after another ball, right? Now think that light is like those small, small balls continuously flowing at a speed of 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second. Okay, it is not just one thing that is flowing. It is one ball coming so fast that you are not able to discriminate between each balls. Okay, so that's the meaning of discretely continuous flow of energy. And those small balls are called as quanta. You understood now, Riya?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that packet, that packet,
not continue.
That packet energy is called as h nu, that value of energy, right? So that means for a light that is, can you mute yourself, Riya? I'm getting disturbed. That light, when it is flowing, it can only be a multiple of h nu, right? This I have given in your class many times example, that if I give you 10 rupee notes bundle, and if I ask you to give 25 rupees out of those 10 rupee notes, you can never give because you have multiple of 10 rupees with you. Similarly, if the energy of the packet, that is quanta, is 1 joule, you can never make it 4.5 joules. You can give 1, 2, 3 or 100 or infinite, but it can never be, even 1000.5 is not possible because minimum value required you have is 1. That is the meaning of En is equal to nh nu. For this, Planck gave a statement that light is quantized. Light is quantized. Okay. This is the definition. Now, quantized means what? It will always be a multiple of some number. Now, here the number is h nu or hc by lambda. Okay, now if somebody asks what is the energy of one quanta of this particular wavelength, you will say h nu. Okay, now if somebody asks you in 1 joule of light, how many quantas are present? Then what you do? You calculate energy of one quanta, then divide 1 by this energy. Okay, so n is equal to En by h nu. Okay, these are the kind of problems that are there. And then one more kind of very important problem that they have asked a few times. I will just quickly do regarding simple light. Okay. Now in the light, I told it is simply flow of photons, right? Now photons are flowing on this light. Now how to understand that? Let's say I have a light source whose power consumption is P. All your bulbs, right? It's rated 11 watt, 12 watt, 18 watt. But every light has its efficiency, right? If you ever try to, you know, remove the, change the bulb in your home, you have to switch it off, leave it for some time. Why? Because it will become hot. That means some of the electrical energy is getting converted to heat energy also. That is the efficiency. That means the power consumed in the form of light will be neta into P, correct? Now the energy of light that is flowing is nh nu. Power is nothing but energy per unit time. So the power of light is n by t, t is the time, into h nu. Now this is in terms of frequency. This should be equal to neta into p. If I do this, I will get n by t, that is number of photons flowing per second is equal to neta into P by h nu. Okay, this is a, you will find in a module 2-3 questions based on this. Okay, this is all about Planck's quantum theory. Are you clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you have doubts, you can ask before I go ahead.
Sir, could you explain the power part once more, the equation that you wrote?
Okay. Power is nothing but energy per time. Okay. So this power which is there, I multiplied with efficiency, I got neta into P. But from the light perspective, energy is nh nu. If I divide by time, I get power of the light that is flowing. Then I equated both this quantity and this quantity. Understood, Sai Paran?
Yes, sir.
Iram, switch off your phone, this thing, video. It will unnecessarily increase the bandwidth. Now, the next very important topic is about photoelectric effect. About photoelectric effect. Iram, please switch off your video. It will unnecessarily disturb others. Thank you. Now, photoelectric effect is observed by, actually explained by Einstein, observed by many scientists. What is observed is, when a metal kept in a vacuum is bombarded with a light, when I keep an electrode here and put a galvanometer, it's observed that current is flowing. Why? Because this light, somebody is not muted, please mute yourself. Iram. Okay, so now when a light is hitting this metal, metal has lot of free electrons, right? That is the definition of a metal. Metal has lot of free electrons. Now the light energy is absorbed by this electron and electron jumps out and participates in the current. Okay, so now for example, if I just consider the surface of the metal, now here an electron is there, it is surrounded by a lot of atoms, so they are trying to pull it. That means it need to overcome all the force from this surrounding atoms and other electrons and come out. Okay, that minimum energy is called as work function. Pooja, please switch off your video. Work function, that is W. Okay, that means the light that is falling on this should have a minimum amount of energy equal to work function for it to able to successfully remove the electron. Okay, so now let's say I am bombarding with a particular frequency of light. So that is h nu. Now that should be equal to W. Then only the electron will come out. But if the electron, light which is bombarding has more energy compared to that work function, that will be, because energy cannot be destroyed nor created, that extra energy is given to the electron in the form of kinetic energy. So this is the equation that is present for photoelectric effect, that the light energy is equal to work function plus kinetic energy. Okay, now the work function is defined as h into nu naught. So this is the minimum frequency of light required, which is equal to work function. This nu naught has a special name called threshold
frequency.
Okay, so that means for a light nu, to give out electron should be greater than nu naught. Similarly, if nu naught is there, I can define lambda naught is equal to nu naught, C by lambda naught is equal to C by nu naught. then lambda should be lesser than lambda naught. Why? Because they are inversely proportional. Okay. This example is given in many textbooks that for sodium, if I use red light whose energy is less, whatever I will do, an electron cannot come. Whereas if I use yellow light whose energy is higher, I can produce an electron out of that. Okay. That means the electron is dependent on the frequency but not intensity. This is the understanding that we should take from photoelectric effect. Okay. So there are a lot of questions based on this given. Okay. There can be different kinds of questions. In your first exam, if you have the paper, Manjana sir given a very good question of, you know, a table is given, which of the following light can remove electron from that. Okay. So first you need to find the work function, then from their threshold frequency, and find who the nu is greater than nu naught, they only can come out. Okay. So this is the kind of
sir, yes. I just have a doubt.
Yeah.
So what happens when we join two metals in vacuum?
What will happen?
No, like in space. This like not related, but I just have a doubt about this.
Nothing comes to my mind. I have to think. What will happen? They will, if they conduct, it will conduct. It's not because metal is there. Space will not matter for it. It's inside, right? Electron will not come out. Electron cannot come. It can flow inside it. And until unless you give potential, electron will not flow. Okay. So this is the understanding of photoelectric effect. Okay. So now the very important part is the Bohr's model. Okay. So before we start the Bohr's model, give me so it's almost 6:50. Okay. So today I will be doing a Bohr's model. After that, we'll have a stop here. Okay, because I'm teaching from last 2.5 hours. You will also be this thing. Other thing we'll again do it another day for the electronic configuration, all that. Okay. I will stop with today with the Bohr's model. Okay. Just middle, I'll just quickly take a small break.
So, we'll
also, yes. Somebody is speaking.
So, can you go back to previous slide and you take of the powers?
Your voice got broken. Can you type and send me? Abhijit?
So I want you to go to the previous slide, the power slide, where you explained about the efficiency and all.
Oh, actually, I'm erasing the slides. It's not a slide, actually. It's a blackboard. I'm erasing the whole thing and then adding. It looks very difficult for me to go back.
Actually, there are layers over there now. You're layering it up. You're not erasing it.
Okay. How will I do that?
Click on a lower layer and you'll go there.
Yeah. Something I did. I don't know what I did. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, next we'll do Bohr's model and then we'll stop for this day. See, the main intention of Bohr's model was to give an understanding of the Rutherford's model. Okay, so the first opening statement of Bohr's model is that this model is applicable for single electron systems. Okay. Basically, it is applicable for hydrogen atom and hydrogen-like atoms. Okay. So, that means around the nucleus, there should only be one electron present. So, that means it is for hydrogen He plus, Li2 plus, Be3 plus, B4 plus and so on. Okay. So, now This is the opening statement of Bohr's model. Now next he said that electrons revolve around the nucleus in stationary orbit or stationary states. Okay, this is the new definition he derived. What is a stationary orbit? These have constant energy. These have constant energy. That means if an electron is present in a stationary orbit, its energy will not change. Okay. So the if you remember the Rutherford's model I taught, the main drawback is that electrons lose energy. So that point got covered here, telling that in a stationary orbit, the energy is constant. Okay. Now the next question asked was, okay, then where is the stationary orbit present? For that he gave that a stationary orbit is can be called a stationary orbit if its angular momentum is quantized. MVR is nothing but angular momentum. Okay, so when it is quantized means what? You see n is there here, right? When I'm, that means the angular momentum is an integral multiple of h by 2 pi. Okay, what is m? Mass of electron, v velocity of electron, r radius of the orbit, n orbit number, h Planck's constant. Did I give the Planck's constant? I think no, right? I just write down Planck's constant. Whoever doesn't know this can write down this. This is the value of Planck's constant. It's a very important value which you should remember. 6.626 into 10 power minus 34. Okay. So this is the magic equation given by Bohr to explain the theory. Okay. Now there was no actual proof for this, but then when after using this equation, when many things are derived like spectrum, etc., it was observed that this equation fits everywhere with the experimental understandings. Okay, because of which Bohr got Nobel Prize. Then the next statement is the n is the orbit number. For someone who somebody asked, n is the orbit number, like first orbit, second orbit, and then for that he gave 1, 2, 3 up to infinity. He gave them names like k, l, m, n, and so on. Next he said, as the radius increases, energy of the orbit increases. That means E1 is greater than E2, but the difference in the energy is reducing. The energy increases, but the difference in the energy is decreasing. Why energy increases? Because think like this in your class, right? Generally, if teacher is not there, you will start doing a lot of noise, right? So similarly, when the electron is out of the purview of the nucleus, it will start doing a lot of other things. That means it's having more energy. Okay. So more away the nucleus, more is the energy of the electron. But the difference in the energy goes on reducing. Okay, this point needs to be noted down. Then the next very important thing he noted was that if an electron is present in an orbit, if energy is given in the form of light to it, it can go to higher energy level. Okay, and this energy that should be given should be exactly equal to the difference of the energy of the orbits. Let's say for argument's sake, I take two energy levels, one at let's say 1 joule, another at say 10 joules. Okay, here electron is present. If the electron has to go from here to here, if the electron has to go from 1 joule energy level to 10 joule energy level, it has to absorb a light of exactly 9 joules of energy. Somebody has switched on their audio. Please switch it off. Mayur has a doubt. Mayur has a doubt? Okay. So what I'm telling you.
No?
Who's this?
It's a Sri Raksha.
Any doubt?
Can you repeat the point once again, sir?
Yeah, I'm repeating. Some disturbance came. What I'm telling is, the electron which is present in a particular energy level, if it has to go to another energy level, it has to absorb a particular amount of energy only. Okay, as I said, example, if 1 joule, 10 joule is there, only if 9 joule comes, it will go. If I give 8 joules, it will not go. If I give 11 joules, it will not go. Okay, because of this, every particular atom absorbs a particular amount of light only. That's like a signature, like a fingerprint of an atom. Okay.
So for 11 joules, why will it not go?
It will not go. Because where it will go here? There is no stationary orbit here, right?
No, like won't it just absorb 9 joules out of the given 11 joules?
No, it has to be exact 9 joules. That is fantastic part of this concept. Okay, because if it absorbs 11 joules, it will go to 11 joules. When it goes to 11 joules, there is no stationary orbit present there. Again, it will fall back.
No, I mean, if we give 11 joules, it will only absorb 9 joules. Na?
No, whatever I give, it will take. It's not like if I give full plate meals to you, you'll only take half plate. Electrons are not like that. If you give something, it will take it full. If it doesn't like, it will not take. If it feels that much energy is not enough or it's more, it will not take that energy. That is the understanding here.
Okay.
So these are the understandings of Bohr's model. Okay. Now from Bohr's model, Manjana sir in the class would have derived many equations. I'm telling you that equations are, the derivation is done for you to understand. In board, nor in competitive exam, in JEE or NEET or CET, for chemistry part, those derivations are important. Okay. It will again be repeated for you in modern physics in second year. Their definitions, derivations are important. Okay. What you need to remember here is radius of nth orbit is radius of first orbit into n square by z, where R1 is equal to 0.529 angstroms or 52.9 picometers. Okay. Then energy of nth orbit is equal to E naught into z square by n square, where E naught is equal to minus 13.6 electron volts or minus, anyone remember the number? 21.8, correct. 21.8 into 10 power minus 19 joules. And total energy of electron is kinetic energy plus potential energy. And total energy is nothing but minus of kinetic energy. And total energy, potential energy is equal to 2 times total energy. Okay. So if you can remember this much from Bohr's model, you can solve every question. I'm not talking about spectrum. For Bohr's model point of view, they can ask this question. What is the ratio of third orbit of He plus atom to that of fourth orbit of hydrogen atom? Like that questions can come, which are asked in JEE. Okay. So please, I am expecting you to remember all this. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, I still have 5 minutes time. I will quickly go into the spectrum part also, and then we'll stop for the day. I hope it's okay if we can extend 5 more minutes for everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you are not, still this video is available. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Bharat is there, huh? Okay, came back.
Sir, now I came, sir.
I messaged in the group long back only.
Oh, sir. I was outside, sir. Sorry, sir. I couldn't see.
No problem. I'll share this video with you.
Yes, sir. I'll see where the Bohr model will come, sir.
Okay. Bohr's model started now. Now, very important understanding is the spectrum. Okay. Spectrum is of two types. Emission spectrum and absorption spectrum. Now, what is this? If I take gas molecules, okay, and I excite them. Let's say I pass light through this, okay. Now if I see from here point of view, whatever light comes out, some of the lambda will be missing from that. Why? Because these atoms will absorb a particular wavelength from this light, okay. For example, if I take WIBGR, white light, that is, pass it through a gas, let's say blue is absorbed by the gas, I will only get VIGOR. So if you just see my left hand foreground, my screen, you'll see the spectrum, right? This is a similar spectrum that is there. Now, if I pass this light, if I do the prism, all that, the blue part will be blank here. It will not be there. Okay. That is meaning of absorption spectrum. Then what is emission spectrum? If I just take the gas molecules and let's say heat them by excitation, then they will start emitting a particular light. That is called as emission spectrum. Okay. Here I take somebody's microphone is on. Please switch off.
Sir, will the color of the emitted and absorbed light will be the same or not?
Yes, that's what I'm telling. If let's say here blue is, if the gases are same here and here, if blue is absorbed, Anish.
Yeah.
If blue is absorbed here, let's take blue only. If blue is absorbed by this, then blue will be emitted by this. Okay, because I told a particular atom will only absorb a particular wavelength whose energy is equal to the difference of the energy levels. Okay, that's why the emission spectrum and absorption spectrum are photographic negatives. Okay, this is the understanding of spectrum. Okay, now Bohr and many scientists tried to calculate the spectrum of hydrogen atom. Okay. The best part is what I will not do the history and the civics again. I will directly come to the point here. Whatever the experiment was done by many scientists and whatever was derived by Bohr, both of them matched with each other, the exact to some decimals, because of which the Bohr's model is accepted. Okay. Now, if let's say I have two energy levels, E1, let's say EN1, and EN2, correct? Now the light that comes for here, right, will be exact difference of this energy level. That means the light emitted whose energy is E is equal to EN2 minus EN1, because EN2 is greater. So this is equal to h nu, light absorbed or emitted is equal to EN2 minus EN1. So if I write now h nu is equal to the previous formula we wrote, right? E is equal to E naught Z square by N square. So I will get for hydrogen atom, Z is equal to 1. So I will get this as E naught by N square. So substitute here, what will I get? E naught will be common into 1 by yes. 1 by N2 square minus 1 by N1 square. So there's a minus here, or minus 13.6 and minus here. Okay. So I can write HC by lambda is equal to E0 into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square, where N2 is greater than N1. Okay. So always when you are using this formula, you make sure that N2 value is greater than N1. See, if you get minus means, that means it is absorbed. That's the only difference. The lambda, what value will come, will be same. Only one extra minus or plus will come. And we know that minus comes means absorption, plus comes means emission, like that. It's just the reverse way. So from this, it is derived that 1 by lambda is equal to RH into 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square, where RH is called as Rydberg's constant, which is equal to 1.0. Why am I forgetting the number? Just a minute. Anyone remembers the Rydberg's constant number? They can post for me.
It's 91.17 nanometers.
No. 109678 centimeter inverse. Okay, 77.5 will come. It's 78. Okay, this is for hydrogen atom only. But for hydrogen like atoms, 1 by lambda is equal to RH into Z square into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square, where N2 is greater than N1. This formula, I'm telling you, in JEE or NEET, they have asked many number of times. Okay, what they will ask is ratio. If you want, you can just have a look.
The constant thing once again, because you said that constant is only for hydrogen. Does that mean that every element has a different...
No. I wrote RH here. I told this equation is for hydrogen.
Okay.
I included Z square here, right? So that will compensate the other factor of the different atom. If He plus is there, Z will be 2. If lithium will be there, Z will be 3. Like that it will.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Okay. Now, question how it will come on this. Now, there's one more very important understanding. I told initially, right? Many scientists have worked on hydrogen spectrum. Okay. So for each spectrum, there is a name given, which you should know. Sorry. Now, if I draw the energy levels. Okay. So this is N is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay, now if I take the first energy level, electron came from 2 level, 3rd level, 4th level, and so on, right? So the spectrum observed when electron comes to the first energy level is called as Lyman series. The spectrum observed when electron falls to second level from any other level is called as
Balmer series.
Not Balmer, it's Balmer.
N silent, sir.
Yeah, Paschen. Then bracket. Then fund. Then Humphrey. Okay. For hydrogen spectrum, only for hydrogen spectrum, Lyman series always falls in UV region. Balmer series falls in visible region. Paschen and all others fall in IR and far infrared. Okay. So these terminologies, this diagram should stay in your brain. Okay. Everyone clear with this?
Yes, now, sir.
This smallest line you are seeing, right? This is called as first line. The next one is second, third, and so on, last line. What is the meaning of last line? There is some infinity level, right? If an electron falls from infinity level to first level, that is called as last line. Okay. So why am I telling this is first line, this is last line. This definition is very important. First line means when an electron is falling from n plus 1 shell to nth shell. Repeating again, first line means an electron is falling from n plus 1 shell to nth shell. Last line means it is falling from infinity to nth shell. Then mth line means it is falling from m plus n shell to n shell. I think little became this thing. I will write it in the... Can I go to the next layer? Okay. Yes, Mayur.
Sir, you said it comes from anything that comes from n plus 1 shell to n shell is called first line, right? Does it apply even if it's 3 to 2 or 4 anyway, to 3?
Yeah.
But okay.
3 to 2 is called first line of Baumer series. 4 to 3 is called first line of Pastian series.
Pastian series, okay.
Understood?
So, yes, sir.
I'm telling that first line means what? N plus 1 to N. Mth line means what? N plus M to N. Last line means what? Infinity to N. Now, N will be defined by the series name. Right? For example, if Lyman series is there, it means 1. If bracket series is there, it means 4. If fund series is there, it means 5. So when I say third line of Baumer series, so as soon as Baumer is there, right, first put 2. Third line means 2 plus 3, that is 5. That means it is from 5 to 2. One more example. If I say ninth line of Lyman series, as soon as a Lyman put 1, ninth means 9 plus 1, that is 10 to 1. Clear? So in my formula, 1 by lambda is equal to RH into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. N1 will be the N which I decide based on Lyman or bracket series. N2 will be decided based on the line number. N2 will be based on the line number. For example, for this I'm writing 1 by lambda is RH into 1 by 2 square minus 1 by 5 square.
Sir, lagging, sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm not able to hear you.
Okay, I'm telling again that in this
equation. Hello, sir, you there?
Yes, yes.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, I have a question. Is it like, you know, an electron is coming from infinity to the first, first orbit? So is it that the electron emits UV rays?
Yes.
Okay. So now suppose it's coming from infinity to the second one. So it's emitting the visible.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Sir, suppose now in the case of lithium, if it was 2 plus only, when it had only one electron.
Lithium, you cannot say. Because for lithium, RH into Z square will come, right? So lambda value will change. That's why I said initially, only for hydrogen spectrum, those UV, IR and all. For other atoms, we cannot say. But I can calculate the wavelength, always.
Okay, sir, I have a question from the module now.
We'll discuss off the offline after the class. I will complete this quickly.
No,
okay. So, for Lyman series 10 to 1, I can write 1 by lambda is RH into 1 by 10 square minus 1 by 1 square. Okay. This is the understanding of spectrum. Now, last part of spectrum is left out. Okay. Give me 1 minute. I will just complete with this. Then we'll stop for the day. Now, we should know which is bigger. Yes, Mayur?
Sir, that same question she asked. She said when it comes from infinity to first orbit.
Yeah.
Yeah, first level, it emits UV rays.
Yes.
But does it not emit all other rays that comes on the way? Like before coming to UV rays, there is
It falls directly, it will only give UV ray. But if it falls one by one, for example, if three levels are there, right? The electron can take many different parts. It can directly fall. If in this place, it will be UV. If it falls like this, then two rays will be emitted. If it falls like this, then three rays, different rays will be emitted.
Got it. Okay. Thank you, sir.
For example, in this case, UV, visible, IR, all three are emitted here. Whereas here, visible and UV only. Whereas here,
only.
Sir, the electron, sir, from N shell to first shell, sir, it can't fall directly, sir.
It can.
That time only UV rays will be emitted, no, sir?
Yes.
But it can fall shell by shell also, sir.
It can fall, then many rays will be coming.
Okay, sir.
So
from n is equal to 2 and n is equal to 1, that time it falls also, it will emit UV, sir, even though potential is potential difference is less.
Yes, yes. One means UV only, sir. Now, first line means, for example, let's take Lyman series. First line means what? 1 by lambda is RH into 1 minus 1 by 2 square, that is 4. Last line means 1 by lambda is equal to RH into 1 by 1 minus 1 by infinity. So this is nothing but 3 RH by 4. This is nothing but RH lambda 2 lambda 1. So lambda 1 is equal to what? 4 by 3 RH. Lambda 2 will be 1 by RH. Which will be greater, lambda 1 or lambda 2? Definitely lambda 1 is greater than lambda 2. Okay. So first line is of longest wavelength. Last line is of shortest wavelength. This you should remember, because this is lower energy, this is higher energy. Then one last part is there. If an atom absorbs a wavelength of lambda, okay, and it takes it, instead of giving lambda back, first it gives lambda 1 and then lambda 2. How can I relate both of this? One thing you should understand, that energy absorbed should be equal to energy emitted. So I can write hc by lambda is equal to hc by lambda 1 plus hc by lambda 2. I can write 1 by lambda is equal to 1 by lambda 1 plus 1 by lambda 2. Okay. So this is the understanding up to Bohr's model. After this, there are some concepts like de Broglie's wavelength, Heisenberg's principle. Then comes quantum mechanical model, then electronic configurations. Okay. So with the time frame.
Sir, when will you do those chapters, sir?
What I will do, I will record them and then post it to you. We'll see. We get some other day in the meantime. We'll do that also. Ramzan also is there. We can do on Ramzan day also. Ramzan is a holiday for you. No classes will be there. That day also we can cover another chapter, maths or some other chapter we'll cover.
Sir, we'll be having college, no, sir?
No, Ramzan is off.
Off, sir.
Check the WhatsApp group now, it will be off.
Oh, okay.
Sir, could you show layer 30 for 1 second? I missed it.
A class is officially over. If somebody wants to leave, they can leave. If you have doubts, you can stay back. Layer?
I'll hear other doubts, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
330.
330, na?
Hmm.
What happened, Tanvi?
Sir, yeah.
Should not use abusive words.
Sir, I didn't know how to use it.
Then don't type. Why you are using gameplay?
Sorry, sir.
Class is over. You can leave. If you have doubts, you can stay back. That's it.
Sir, I missed the whole class. Like, can
Who is this?
If you don't mind, can you explain it briefly?
I will share the video. I have recorded this video. I will share it on Google Drive. You can see.
Hello.
I have shared the video on Google Drive. Hello? Hello, who's asking that question? Somebody asked something.
Sir, I think she's not able to hear what you're telling. She's not got the audio.
Okay.
I think she has not dialed in, sir.
Yeah.
Or she has some audio.
Okay. Whatever it is, the video will be available. So anytime you can refer it. Always.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you very everyone for joining.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So one question, sir.
Yeah.
There's one question like Bohr's orbits of hydrogen.
Mm-hmm.
To which of the following electron transitions in the Bohr's orbit of hydrogen does the fourth line in the Balmer series correspond?
Fourth line means what? Balmer means 2. 2 plus 4, 6. 6 to 2.
6 to 2. Okay. Thank you.
If you are done, Tanvi, you can leave. Class is over officially. Abhijit, Was it good? Everyone who was left out? Mayur, Tanisha? Any
yes,
feedback?
Sir. It really helped. It helped.
But whom I wanted, they didn't join. BGS, like NPS also, like Pratik and I think Yash was there. Pratik was not there. Shreyas was not. Shreyas is coming to class, huh? Mayur?
Sir?
Shreyas is coming to class?
No, sir. He's not coming. It's from Beans. I think around 15 days. He's not coming to school.
Okay.
I mean, he had some issue with the library teacher, actually. I think he gave a letter she did not accept or something. So, I think he left. I'm not sure. Okay.
Who is this Sri Lakshmi Samyukta? I just want to know. Tanisha, Iram, Sneha. Sneha, you can leave. It's over. Can I end the meeting now? Everyone? Mayur?
Yes, sir.
Aran left, na?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, guys.
Thank you, sir.
Meet some other day.
Bye.